Welcome to Actions and Limits. My name is Justin Atherton. I'm a personal coach and the founder of Confidence Unchained. With me as always is Paul Fortune. Paul is a business coach and the founder of A Call to Action. And together we make Actions and Limits. Welcome to the show, the podcast where we talk about the actions we can take and the limits we create. Another week, Paul. How's it going, man?
Another week, a great week. I'm doing well. How about yourself?
I'm doing great. I'm doing fantastic. I know you said you had something to share, a quote to share with everyone.
Yeah, I heard this quote and it resonated with me and I wanted to share with everybody and wanted to hear your thoughts on it, Justin. So the quote is this: be the person that you needed when you were younger.
Wow, that's really interesting to think about.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Pretty deep. So I started thinking about what I needed when I was younger. I would have needed a person that was confident, calm, and basically to tell me that a lot of the stuff that you're going through right now, all good. It's in the scheme of things, it's fine. You know, it's nothing that should, you know, take over your life and make it feel like it was the end of the world, because it really wasn't. And, you know, now looking back at the stuff that I was, you know, affected me as a kid or high school or junior high, a lot of stuff, my worries, I look back and, you know, they're trivial to, you know, what I worry about today. You have your parents and stuff, but, you know, sometimes, you know, the message from your parents, because they're always talking to you, you know, you don't listen to it, you know, you kind of just kind of start ignoring it, you know? So if you had, you know, some sort of mentor, sure, on the outside that you trusted, you know, giving me this advice, you know, it might be different, but, you know, coming from your mom or your dad or whoever, sometimes, you know, you ignore it, you know, and they could have told me exactly what I'm telling myself now, but I would not have listened to it. I probably didn't listen to it because the worry or whatever was bothering me at the time was so much. It was huge. And yeah, what my mom was telling me is, no, you don't know. You're not feeling what I'm feeling. And, you know, you forget, you know, they were in high school or junior high or whatever. So, you know, they probably went through some of the same stuff, sure, you know, that I went through and such. So what's your take on it?
Yeah, it's interesting because I've heard something similar before, you know, because I just want to make sure I'm getting the quote right. You said, be the person that you needed when you were younger, right?
That's right. That was the quote.
Yeah, it kind of makes me think of a different aspect that I've heard in some trainings I've been to, some communication courses, where they talk about how later in life we act in ways that, you know, maybe a certain situation that we failed or we were less than. And so we start thinking, well, who could I have become in that situation to succeed in that? So it to me, it sounds kind of similar, but yeah, I get what you're saying. Like, you know, be able to look back at your life, and whether it was when you're a kid, like I can see this, like, you know, if I were there for me, you know, 5-7 years ago, even, and, yeah, and been able to, you know, be the person that I needed then, you know, be like, hey, look, dumbass, this is what you're doing. These are the things where you're getting in your way. Like, hey, this is how it's going to affect your life. You know, snap out of it, you know, stop doing this stuff. You know, that I think we don't have to go back to when it's being a kid, right? It could be, you know, our past self, yeah, 5-10 years ago.
It could be last month.
Yeah. You know, because we're always growing. So yeah, it's, yeah, that's a really interesting quote and a lot of stuff to think about, along with that. So
what qualities you mentioned, 7 years ago, what qualities, did you need from somebody at that point in time?
Well, you know, I think I've touched on it in some of the other episodes we've talked about is, you know, I wasn't as developed in my emotional intelligence or that emotional fortitude. And so I wasn't exposed to the idea of, you know, being able to, you know, handle those reactions to your emotions. And so, you know, maybe just having someone to explain that or run through the process or the idea. And this comes up for me too. So there's different types or categories of knowledge, right? So we know the things that we know, right? So that's one of the three. So there's things that we know, right? And we can use those things and we can become more proficient at those things. The second category is things we know that we don't know. So I know I don't know how to speak French. I know I don't know how to sew a blanket. So, you know, those things we can either pay someone else to do them, or we can learn them and train on them and move them into the categories of something that we know, right? If you learn Spanish, it moves from something you know that you don't know into the category of something you know that you know. The third category is the hard part. These are the things that we don't know that we don't know. And you can't make a list of those things because you don't know them, right? So it's about being exposed to new ideas, about talking to new people and expanding your horizons, whether it's reading new books or, again, just being exposed to new ideas through different avenues. And then being able to take those things and implement them and either turn them into things that you know or realize that they're there and have someone else either explain it to you or help you with it. So
you may have mentioned it, and I apologize if you did, but can you give me an example of what you didn't know that you didn't know 7 years ago?
Yeah, it was related with emotions. You know, I remember thinking that I believed that I could control my emotions from coming up. And I thought that anytime I felt an emotion, meaning that I let it slip out, that I was weak, that I lost control over not being able to feel those emotions or not being able to restrain those emotions. So whether I became sad or angry or whatever, and I was like, oh, dang it, I let that one slip out. I lost control. You're not realizing and not understanding how emotions work. Like, we can't control emotions from coming up. We just cannot. You know, they process through the limbic system and our parts of our brain before our cognitive brain kicks in. And so realizing that, going, oh, it's literally just a biological process that happens within our brains before we have a chance to think about it. But realizing then, what can we control? Our reactions to our emotions. So it wasn't about, you know, being weak for letting these emotions come up. Now it's new knowledge that I have, right? I'm like, oh, okay. Now I laugh thinking back to the way that I thought before, you know, the lack of knowledge that I had surrounding emotions.
I'm definitely not making light of what you're talking about because I know it's very serious, and it was very good growth of you to be able to grow and evolve to who you are now. But what you were talking about kind of reminded me of Frank Costanza. When he got mad, he would yell, "Serenity now! Serenity now!" You know, and it was like what you're talking about. Like, it was unproductive. I mean, yeah. He was just bottling up his feelings. I mean, it did nothing but just made him more angry.
Yeah, good Seinfeld reference there. Yeah, and that's how a lot of men grow up. They're told, you know, if you do show emotions that you're weak. So, and it's definitely not productive to try to bottle those up and try to suppress them. So,
I agree, but I think, you know, everybody bags on the millennial generation, but I feel like the millennial generation, the men, are way more in touch with their feelings than other generations in the past. So, you know, you can say what you want about the millennial generation, but I think a lot of them are way more in touch with their feelings and not afraid to show it, mm-hmm. as opposed to generations in the past. So, you know, I think that's a feather in their cap, so to speak.
Sure. But there's an interesting bell curve, because I've had this conversation with other people before, because yes, we should recognize our emotions and understand that it is a process. But when you let your emotions run your decision-making, when you let your emotions run wild, because you're so in touch with them and you don't rein them in, you don't understand the reactions that you can control, then you run amok. When you're constantly making emotional decisions and you're not basing anything in logic, that's the other side of the bell curve, when you're letting emotions just run wild, because you have to have a good combination of, you know, emotional and logical decision making together to be able to live a rational life. If everything is just based on facts and no emotions, like Mr. Spock in Star Trek, that's not rational. But then the other side, when you're being completely emotional and letting your emotions run the show, that's not rational either. You have to have a good combination of the two. So yes, maybe the millennial generation has more in touch with their emotions, but maybe they need to keep them in check a little bit more and understand their reactions to their emotions. So there's a bell curve there.
Yeah. I mean, I like to see statistics on it, you know, on that. So, you know, I guess only time will tell on that, but yeah, I agree with you, what you're saying. I mean, if you make emotional, especially in the business world, if you're making an emotional decision, that's going to really hurt you.
Yeah. You have to have some emotion involved in certain things, but don't let it run amok. So.
No, no question. I mean, emotion can help you push you to your goals. I mean, sure. You can be passionate about something and that's emotional. I'm a passionate person. So, and you know, sometimes I need to reel it in, but sometimes I think it helps me. I think people see that passion that I have and appreciate that about me. It's a part of my personality. You talk about, you know, you got to be authentic to yourself. So part of my personality is being passionate, being a little over the top. I try not to be too over the top, but a little over the top. And they're like, oh, that's Paul being Paul.
Paul being Paul. Yeah, it goes back into, you know, emotions being either useful or not useful. You know, if it's useful to help you accomplish your goal, great. If it's not, then you might have to reevaluate. So, especially all these conversations people have with that are emotionally charged. So it ends up not being very useful when people are having debates or conversations on heated topics. So something to think about. And I definitely liked that quote. So it was definitely a good conversation starter there. So let's touch on our sponsor before we dive into our topic for today. So again, for our episode, Frontline Standard Apparel is our sponsor. You can find them at frontlinestandardapparel.com. And they are a patriotic apparel company. And they're run by a former U.S. Marine who now works as a police officer, Patrick, and he runs it with his wife, and their company's based out of Texas. And a portion of all their profits goes towards a nonprofit organization that supports first responders and military. And they just want all of us to look good while we're supporting our first responders and our military. So again, thank you, Frontline Standard, for continuing to be our sponsor through this new year. So I'm excited about this new topic. And I know you and I have talked about it a little bit before. I think it really, people are going to fall on either side of the fence on this. It's definitely something to make you think. This is an idea I got from a book written by Ayn Rand back in, I believe, the 50s or 60s. And there was a lot of controversy over it then. And her book was The Virtue of Selfishness. And the idea from that book is that selfishness is not a bad thing. you know, and her stance was that it should be a virtue, because we've taken the word selfish or selfishness and turned it into something that's bad, when really the word is based on one of the definitions I pulled up earlier was concerned with one's own welfare. So it's like, how can that be bad? You know, to be concerned with your own welfare. So are we supposed to put other people's needs and wants above our own? So I don't really believe that selfishness is a bad thing. I think it's good to be able to be selfish. So what are your thoughts on that, Paul?
I agree with you, and it reminds. Have you ever seen the movie Wall Street?
Possibly. It's been a while though.
With Michael Douglas and Charlie Sheen.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Michael Douglas had a scene. I'm not going to go over the or had a speech. I'm not going to go over the whole speech with you, but I'm going to tell you one line from it. And the line was, "Greed is good," and he's basically telling you that, you know, that you need to be selfish to be successful in the business world.
Sure.
You need to, you know, put aside other people's wants for your wants. You need to go after what you want. And if you don't do that, you're not going to be successful in business. And it's, you know, it's a dog eat dog world in the business world, especially in Wall Street. Mm-hmm. You have to look out for number one, or they're going to bulldoze you. They'll spit you out. If you're not in it to win it, unfortunately, you know, you're going to be pushed aside. Obviously, you know, not everybody's going to have that career. Not everybody's going to have that strong of a mindset. But I think if you have a passion about something, whatever that is, you have to have a little bit of selfishness in yourself to accomplish that goal. And the selfishness part of it could be your confidence. Like, no, I'm going to do this. Somebody's going to tell you, no, you can't do this. No, I will do this. And to me, that's selfishness, and that's good. You know, because you are showing that you have confidence in yourself that you're going to accomplish the task. So yeah, I think I'm on the same spectrum as you on that one.
Yeah, it's very interesting, and for those that that really are sticking to that idea that selfishness is a bad thing, the idea is that everything that we do benefits us in some way. Okay, whether we are giving to someone else, whether your business is surrounded about helping other people, you're still receiving that benefit. If it's your passion to go out there and help people, right, you receive a benefit from that. Like every time I help a client, every time I help them discover a new possibility and succeed, like I get a benefit from that, right? Yes, there's a monetary aspect to it, but it's also like, man, like I did something good. Like I'm doing right by my clients. I'm helping them. You get that endorphin release, which is still,
to me, that's not a bad thing.
No, it's not. But so I believe that there is no such thing as an unselfish act. Everything we do benefits us in some way or another, whether we're helping somebody or we're doing it ourselves. And people, that I think that's an idea that people get really stuck on. I think the best example I've seen, and I think you and I have talked about this before, say we're walking down the street and there's a homeless person asking for money. Okay. So I walk by and he's asking for a dollar, and I'm like, no, I'm keeping my dollar because I worked hard for this. You know, you can get it from somebody else. So I'm being selfish because I kept my dollar. You know, I'm keeping my hard-earned money. And so I walk by, and then he asks you for a dollar, and you give him a dollar. Well, what's the benefit that you receive from that? You know, you feel better about yourself. Hey, I helped this guy out. I did something for him, you know. Or maybe you're preventing yourself from feeling guilty because if you walk by him and don't give him a dollar, maybe you'll feel guilty. So you're actually preventing that negative emotion from being triggered. So in any form or fashion, you are receiving a benefit of whether you give him a dollar or whether you don't. So it's all about, because we think about helping our kids. You know, anything I do for my daughter, guess what? That benefits me and my family, right? Because if anything happened to her, you know, I wouldn't be able to live with myself if it was something I could have prevented. So I look out for her and her well-being, but in a sense, it's watching over my well-being too, or maybe my mental and emotional well-being as well. So anything we do benefits us in one way or another. So it's not a bad thing to look out for yourself first. You know, like they talk about when you're on an airplane, you know, put your mask on first before you put it on the person next to you, even if it's your kids, because you're no good if you're suffocating, right? And think about in your business, in your personal life, you know, if you are so worried about everyone else and you're putting everyone else's needs first because you're going to feel guilty if you don't, then you're suffocating yourself. And then you're no good to anyone. And it's just unsustainable. So it's an interesting concept to think about, but definitely links up to self-care too, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely. You want to take care, like we talked about, the airplane thing is something that I always mention. You got to put your mask on first before you help anybody else. And that's the same thing about, you know, you being a parent. You know, you need, you know, a lot of parents don't do this, but they need to do this, is they don't do their physical care to themselves. A lot of them get caught up in their day-to-day grind, helping their kids, helping their wife, helping whoever out, but they forget, you know, to eat right. You know, they're going, you know, fast food every day because it's quicker, and I get it, because some days that's, you know, what I do. You know, they're not going out and exercising, going out, oh, you know what, I had a long day at work, I just helped the kids with the homework, I don't want to go and take a walk or go to the gym. Yeah. I just want to just watch TV. And you're not doing the self-care. I know life takes over and you're busy and you get tired, but you got to take care of yourself, because if you don't, you know, you go to the doctor and say, and your doctor goes, whoa, you're obese. And obese is only 30 pounds overweight. There's a lot of people in the world that are 30 pounds overweight, and that's considered obese. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and I'm not talking about a vain thing. I'm just talking about health. I mean, if you're 30 pounds overweight, there's a lot of stuff that can go wrong there. And sure. You're not doing a service to your kids, because you're not going to be around to help them when they need your help, because you're going to be sick, you know, heart attack, stroke, and now you're bedridden. Now you can't go to work. Now you can't support for your family. So if you're not selfish and doing your self-care, you're hurting your family.
Yeah. And think about the other aspect that flows into too, because you know, that's one of the things I talk about, those three key areas. So we're talking about health, but think about how your lack of self-care emotionally or your lack of self-care mentally, how all of those factor into how you interact with people. So if you're not taking care of yourself and you're getting stressed out, you're not taking your care of your own health, you're not making sure that your mentality is on check, you keep you focused, those interactions you have with your kids and your spouse, they're going to suffer. And so those relationships are going to end up suffering, because how well are you taking care of your kids when you're stressed out? How well are you taking care of your spouse when you're like, when you're not focused? And, you know, and like you touched on, the overall lack of health affects every aspect. You know, it affects your own confidence, which is, it's almost like this snowball effect, right? You start this lack of self-care, and it starts whittling away at each aspect of your life, your mentality, your emotional fortitude, and your health consciousness. And then pretty soon, like, you're useless to anybody, and you're not a functional or high functioning person. And, you know, it's going to show up at work. It's going to show up at home. And so, you know, there have been times in my life where I realized I was like, hey, I'm not doing a good job taking care of my daughter today because I'm, you know, out of whack. You know, if I was going through a super stressful time and it was just me and her, I clearly remember one time calling her mom and being like, hey, I think you need to come pick up our daughter because I am not in a good headspace today to be able to handle taking care of her efficiently. It wasn't a safety thing or anything, but it was just like I was not in a good headspace at that time. This was several years back. I remember that moment very clearly because it was it hit me hard realizing that I wasn't able to efficiently care for my daughter because I was not taking care of myself and realizing, hey, I need to focus on myself for a minute. And I got some harsh words from some friends for admitting that. And it's like, oh no, you should have been able to just suck it up and take care of your daughter. Well, sure, I was meeting her basic needs. You know, she was eating, she was being taken care of, and you know, she was getting enough rest. But was I interacting with her? Was I really there? Was I being present? No, I wasn't. You know, I was.
Were you
just
lucky that you had somebody to take your kid while you weren't able to do that? A lot of parents don't have that luxury. Yeah. If they're not in the right headspace, all well. I mean, there's nobody else going to take that kid, so they just kind of have to suck it up and keep going because that's it. They don't have anybody. So I mean, grateful that you do have that. You have a loving mother of your child that took over for you when you couldn't do it.
Yeah. And I get that some people don't have that, but what ends up being the impact? Like say I didn't have somebody, what am I going to do? Stick my daughter in front of the television or make her go in a room and play? Like think about the trickle down effect, you know, that has, or if it's a relationship, you
know? What example would you give? Because I'm sure there's parents out there that don't have that luxury, that are sometimes in the wrong headspace. What would you suggest that they do? Is there a technique or something that you could do to help? Because sometimes that option is not on the table.
Sure, and I get that. I think a big thing is that admitting that, you know, you need help, right? Like that was a big thing, and that was an emotional moment for me. I remember that. You know, realizing like, hey, I need to stop. I need to take care of myself because I'm mentally and emotionally not here. And it can be a tough thing to admit, right? You know, sometimes asking for help is the hardest thing. And so I was able to do that. You have to fit. No one's situation is the same, right? You know, so if you don't have that support group, you have to figure out something, whether it's, you know, something you can do together. If you need to make your spouse or your kids part of whatever your selfish activity needs to be for your own self-care, hey, we're going to go do this, you know, because I need to, you know, you're going to come with say it's your spouse. It's like, hey, I need to go get a massage. You can come or you can stay. Like you can pick, but this is what's happening. Because I need this. So I'm sure that there's everyone's situation is different. So I don't know what I would suggest other than admitting that you need that and realizing that that's happening. So then you can make a plan. Because if you just go on limping through your life, like going, I'll just make it, I'll just barely make it through, you're not really interacting with anyone because you haven't admitted to yourself that there's an issue. So I really think owning up to whatever that failure is in your life or that lack is, then you can make a plan, whatever plan is appropriate for you. So I think that's the key.
Yeah. So I guess that it's tough. I mean, there really is no clear-cut answer on that. I do feel for parents that are in that situation, that are not in the right headspace, but can't do much about it because, you know, their kid's 4 years old and, you know, they don't have any family or friends to help take care of them. And, you know, the only time that you get a break is when you're at work. So it's tough on you. And my hat goes out to you. My hat goes off to you because I don't know what I would do in that situation. The only thing I can say is this is when you you jump off the deep end, majority of the time you're going to find a way to get to safety.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's kind of that fight or flight thing. You know, if you have to do something and there's no other way, you're going to do it. You're going to find a way because it's survival.
Yeah, but think about how many different aspects that flows into. Say it's in your business life, right? And you're just overwhelmed and you're just not in a good headspace. You know, maybe you need to ask for help at work. If it's like, hey, look, I'm going to go on vacation. Like, I need you to take over these accounts. I need some help with this project here. And, you know, asking for that help, realizing that there's an issue, realizing that you need time away for your self-care, being selfish. Okay. And asking for that help in whatever aspect it is. And I think that's really hard for some people to do, whether it's a relinquish of control or whether they have a lack of trust in the people that they work with or their team. Because I've talked to several different business owners and entrepreneurs that just that have this underlying lack of trust that anyone else can run the company or make decisions. And it leads to this burnout because they want to be the ones making every single decision. But when you realize you need to be selfish, hey, ask for help.
Yeah, I can feel empathy though on the business side of things, especially if you're commission based, and you know when you, and if you're not working, you're not making money. So I have some empathy for you about, you know, it's hard to take a break when you know when you're taking a break, you're not making money.
Yeah,
that is tough. But I will tell you this. Sometimes when you're just grinding it out, you're not efficient. And sometimes if you stick away for, you know, a few days or a week or whatever you need, and you come back, sometimes that makes you more efficient and you actually make more money because you're thinking clearer.
Yeah, you step away, and we've talked about in some other episodes, stepping away, you know, clearing your mind and coming back to it with like this refreshed look. Whether it's redefining your why, you know, that we talked about before, or, you know, just clearing out your mind, like clearing out all that extra baggage and making sure to pay attention to your own self-care and be selfish. It's okay to be selfish. It's not a negative word. It's only a negative word if we put that on to it. Like, as a society, we've made the word selfish negative when really it's not. It's about focusing on your own well-being and your own interests, which isn't a bad thing, right?
No, it's not. But it kind of goes back to what you were talking about earlier about being too emotional. I mean, I feel like you could be too selfish too.
Sure.
You know, to your own detriment or to other people's detriment. You know, if you're constantly just, you know, almost narcissistic and just only looking out for you, you're going to fall because what's going to happen is you're just going to alienate people. Like this guy or girl only thinks about themselves. I'm going to put my wall up on this person because I don't trust them. They're only looking out for them. They are not helping anybody else. I'm not going to give them a time of day, and that will affect you in business and in your personal life.
Sure. And it comes back to that interesting dichotomy because that idea that there's no such thing as an unselfish act. So everything that we do benefits us in some way or another. But what you're saying is just focusing on our own needs and never focusing on the needs of others, which there should be another word for that. We need to invent another word for it. You know, it's literally just not paying attention to the needs of others. But I think we use selfishness to, you know, define that when really it's the word selfish really has a couple different layers to it. you know, some language, like, what is it? The native language, for the Eskimos, like, has 27 different ways to define snow. You know, why don't we have more than one way to define selfishness? You know, whether it's looking out for your own needs and the needs of other people, or focusing only on your needs, which I can see how that would be detrimental to relationships, to business, to any aspect of your life. But again, I come back to this aspect, you know, as coaches, as consultants, we receive a benefit by helping other people, but we're still being selfish, right?
Well, maybe you should contact Webster, right, and come up with some new words for selfishness.
Yeah, I'm going to get right on that. I'm going to send them.
Right after we're done with the show, I think that's what you should do.
Directly, I'm going to send them an email and be like, Mr. Webster, we need to add a word. We need to add a couple variations of the word selfishness in here. No, I get where you're coming from. If you are only focused on your needs and never focused on anyone else's, that is not an efficient way to live your life. You're obviously not going to build strong relationships. And I think that really ties into your emotions around different things. And so, like, if you're not developed in your emotional fortitude, you're not going to be able to relinquish some of that control. If you're not able to delegate and let other people make decisions and trust them, you know,
trust, that is the word. I was just about to say that, you just mentioned it, but trust, that's the trust. If you're so selfish that you can't think about anybody else, then other people are not going to trust you. Yeah. And that'll be in your personal life, and that'll be in business too, because yeah, you're not going to be in business very long if people can't trust you, because there is a lot of trust that's involved in business and definitely in your personal life. And if you fail in trust, that's a long road.
Yeah, and it's something that takes forever to gain, and you can lose in an instant, right?
Yeah, 2 seconds.
Yeah, trust is an interesting thing, but yeah, so it's weird, you know, when we're using that word selfishness, you know, because I get it, you know, there's. We don't want to be like on that one side of the bell curve, like we said, where we're just focused on our own needs. And we don't want to be on the other side where we're only focused on everyone else's needs. So you have to have that middle ground, right? To where you do focus on the people around you that are important to you, your business, and you also focus on your own needs. Like, it's not a bad thing. So finding that middle ground, or that ebb and flow back and forth, you know, on that scale, you know, is part of that balance of life, right?
100%.
Yeah,
it is. You know, balance is key to a lot of great things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we never, and again, you know, we've talked about it before, you're never in complete balance.
No.
So it's
for human beings.
Yeah.
That's impossible.
Mm-hmm. So it's that constant flow. So maybe this week I'm more focused on my family's needs and my business needs. Well, guess what? Next week I need to balance that out some. I need to take an extra day for me, you know, to recover from that and restore my own energy levels so I can come back at 100% in every aspect of my life. So, yeah. Selfish.
Right.
Be more selfish.
All right. You have a selfish question for Ask Paul Anything?
I don't think I have a selfish question. I did have you know, a question that came up here. And this is from so for our segment Ask Paul Anything, right? This is from Ginger in Alabama. And she says, Paul, what do you think is a common mistake people make when starting a business?
That's a great question. A question that I've been asking myself. I would say the most common mistake that people do when they're running a business is not being prepared. I think a lot of people sometimes just kind of wing it and spend all kinds of money on frivolous things and realize, hey, I'm not generating any money, but I'm spending all this money. It's just not adding up. So I would say that not having a strong business plan is probably the most common mistake that that self-employed people fall into. Yeah. Great question, Junior.
Yeah. Thank you for the question. It, even maybe moving too fast kind of goes along that same line, like trying to grow too fast. But yeah, no, I like that. So again, Ginger, thank you for your question. So this is a good episode, Paul. I know it will probably spark some interesting comments about selfishness and how, you know, we should be more altruistic. And so I'm kind of curious to see what kind of conversations it's going to spark. But for me, I think everyone should be more selfish. Make sure you're getting that self-care in, making sure you're paying attention to your needs. And then once that's taken care of, then you can take care of those around you that are important to you.
Well, I'm going to be selfish right now. I got to eat, so I'm wrapping this up. For Justin Atherton, this is Paul Fortune. See you next week.
All right. See you next Monday. Thank you for listening to the show. Remember to leave a comment and tell us what you thought about today's episode. Follow us on your favorite podcast platforms. We're on Apple, iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Spotify, TuneIn, and featured on Podbean. Follow us on Instagram at ActionsandLimits and stay updated on all the upcoming content. If you have any outrageous questions for our section Ask Paul Anything, submit them to actionsandlimits@gmail.com and your question could be featured on the show.